We'll get started. Hey, everybody, thanks for coming. This is my first time to be at this conference. So it's, how many of you first time? Oh, wow, great, yeah. So it's, any of you are Java developers? Okay, a few. So hopefully after this talk, if you don't use Java, hopefully you can consider to use Java. So this talk is about cloud native application development with MicroProfile and Open Liberty. I'm Emily Jiang, I'm a Java champion. I work for IBM as a cloud native architect and chief advocate. So it's this session, it has a lot of content. So I kind of go through the basic concept and followed by a demo. And also is good news is we have an IBM stand that has will give away 200 copies. The book I co-authored is over here. So it's please come to the come to IBM booth to grab a copy. So I will have more details towards the end. So it's I talk about cloud. So it's basically what a cloud demand. One thing you need to remember in the cloud, everything need cost money. So it's your application need to be really small, so use less memory and very fast. So it's kind of the, it's basically start up very fast and respond fast as well. Because I talk about Java, so obviously if you run Java, you need a JVM. Your JVM, again, need to be small and fast. So it's there's two very popular JVM. One is Oracle Hotspot. The other one is the open source project called OpenG9. Any of you have heard of OpenG9? Okay, good. If you haven't, check it out. OpenG9 is very performant. So it has kind of the very small and very fast. So it's, what are cloud native applications? Can I ask, is a microservice a cloud native application? Yeah, but cloud native application, not only microservices. Some monoliths also can be cloud native application. So it's to be considered to be a cloud native application, it has need to have these seven characteristics. So first thing is it need to be RESTful. Basically, for this, you need to be able to scale up or down without losing any information. Also, it need to be configurable. So basically, you can externalize the configuration. You can change the config value without redeploy your application. Again, your application need to be very resilient. It should respond under all kinds of different circumstances. And again, when you talk about cloud native application, need to run in the cloud. So it needs to be self advertised itself. So it should be, can be discovered. And again, it needs to be secure. Some cloud native application contain some sensitive data, so you need to be secure it. And the last two is very important for DevOps. So it's it needs to traceable, needs to monitorable. So if something is not running right, is some operation failed, you need to figure out which application is having a problem so you can fix it. And finally, is your application needs to be intelligent. So it's able to communicate with cloud infrastructure regarding whether it's ready to receive a request or is it still alive. So if it's not, so Kubernetes can destroy it and start up a new instance. So you know it's kind of that this is a whole list. And as application developer, we are paid for writing business logics. And your daytime job is kind of too daunting if it's, you have to consider all kind of things. So luckily, MicroProfile comes to help. So it's come to rescue. So MicroProfile is open source project under Eclipse Foundation. So here are a lot of projects under Linux Foundation, but MicroProfile is under Eclipse Foundation and it's governed by the MicroProfile Working Group. So this is MicroProfile project is the standard for creating Java-based cloud native applications. So it's completely community driven. It's a spec, API, TCK is public and under Maven Central. It has many implementations. So it has open liberty. Also IBM has a WebSphere liberty. And there's a Red Hat, has a Wildfly, Quarkus, and also the like a Kubernetes, Oracle has a Helidon, and et cetera. So it's, there's a lot of implementations for you to choose from. So in this talk, I will talk more about open liberty as one of the implementation of MicroProfile. I will demo in a minute. So it's MicroProfile releases. MicroProfile has been around for more than 5 years. So it started from the 2016. And later last year, we released MicroProfile 5. And also last year, we released 4.1. So this is the functionality difference is kind of the very minimal. So it's 4.1, so it's aligned with the Jakarta EE 8. And this one aligned with the Jakarta EE 9.1. So basically it's the JavaX and Jakarta namespace change. Any of you have heard of MicroProfile? Okay, hopefully afterwards you all know a bit. MicroProfile. What about Jakarta EE? Any of you? Okay, so that's good. So in MicroProfile, there's two kinds of releases. One is the platform release. So this is 13 pillars. I will discuss them in more detail. Again, the standalone releases. So this top two is for creating reactive microservices. So this is for the asynchronous programming. And this use GraphQL, the REST alternative. This is for microservice transaction. So it's long-running actions. So I will talk about these 13 pillars in a scenario. So it's basically how to create the first cloud native applications. As you know, REST is very popular. So MicroProfile has a solution for it. So use REST. So you create two classes application. And this one is JaxRS resources. With these two applications, you have endpoint, slash system, and slash properties. And then you can directly invoke getting properties, you get a response. And then for the cloud native application, so in order to create a loosely coupled application, so inside you use the context dependency injection. So basically, it's, with the context dependency injection, you do not need to call the constructor anymore. In Java, you know, you call constructor to create instances. So here, CDI container will directly manage all the instances for you. And then whenever you say at inject, it will fish out an instance and inject into this variable. So, and then, like I talk about payload. So for the payload, the most popular payload, again, is JSON. So that's a language agnostic. So it's in Java, it uses JSONB and JSONP to help you. So here, when you say, okay, payload is JSON, all you need to do add produces, so JSON. And then, so the type inventory list, you can declare this class inventory list. And then what a JSONB implementation directly is serialized and deserialized this object, when it's put to wire, serialize it. When it's retrieved from wire, it's deserialized for you. So you don't need to serialize it yourself. When you talk about cloud native applications, normally you deal with many of them. So how can you connect them? How can you just from service A directly call into service B? So in MicroProfile, we have a solution. So we have a MicroProfile REST client. So basically in B, if I want to call the B's operation get properties, in A, I directly create an interface of the B. So system client, so it's got it's get operation. All I need to do is annotate with register REST client. And then in A's other classes, you can direct it to add inject REST client and inject instance of it. And then you can directly call the, any operation on here, like get properties. And you might think, how does A know where B lives? So that's by the configuration. So you do fully qualified the system client, so blah, blah, and then slash mpres slash URL. So this is the service B's backend. So whenever you call default REST client.get properties, it will go here and directly call the backend. And then the next thing is how can you document your application? So we use MicroProfile Open API. So that's directly based on the Open API standard. Even though you don't know Java, some of know Java, don't use Java. Any of you know Open API standard? Okay, so that's good. So it's in MicroProfile Open API is based on API standard, and it has an endpoint, host, port, and slash Open API. So here is directly the response. And also, we use the implementation Swagger. So this is, if you know Swagger, that's directly identical to Swagger output. So in Open Liberty, we also have an endpoint UI, integrated UI, Swagger UI. So, and then you can directly invoke the operation from directly from this UI. So next one is the secured microservices or secure cloud native applications. So it's if, for example, here, like a get properties for host, you want to secure it. So you will use like a Jakarta security, just say roles allowed, so which only means admin or user can allow access this like operation. So in this case, like when service A call into service B, it will pass the JWT token. Do you know JWT JWT? Anybody else? Okay, cool. So this is JWT, so it's a MicroProfile JWT directly added to claims. One is UPN, so for the user, the other one groups to say which group you belong to. So it's in this case, B receive response and can work out which group you belong. If you belong to admin, yes, you can access this backend. So this is security. The next thing is how to create resilient microservices. So we use MicroProfile fault tolerance. So it's basically you can it's fault tolerance provide a retry capability, timeout, circuit breaker, and bulkhead. So it's for a limit how many concurrent requests, and also fallback. So it's so this fallback operation, you can specify if this one failed, alternative method can be invoked to return a good response. By the way, each slide has this URL, so directly pointed to the MicroProfile repository. So the next one, externalize the configuration. So basically, this is the MicroProfile config provide a way for you to store your configuration external to your application. So inside uses the MicroProfile config, inject a property into a variable, and then this property can be specified in the config sources. In MicroProfile, it can be a MicroProfile config properties, environment variable, system property, and also customer config source can all specify this property. And then it will have associated config ordinal. So if you specify in multiple places, the config source with the highest number as the config ordinal will overrule. So here, like this is 150. So in maintenance, it will be true when it's inject. So next thing is a cloud infrastructure. If you want to deploy application to the cloud, you must do the health metrics and open tracing. So for the health, basically it has MicroProfile health provide readiness, liveness, and also startup. So for you to put a business logic to specify when it's ready. And also it has endpoint /health/ready and /health/live to display the result. So next thing is metrics. So you can add the application metrics by using MicroProfile metrics annotation like at a time and simply time and counted and et cetera. And one thing is all the RESTful services and method is automatically add some metrics automatically. So I will show you in a minute. So the next thing is kind of this is for debug purpose. If something not working and it will if something not working it will just be able to help you like where it's not working. So it's all the good news is all the like RESTful invocation automatically traced. And also if you want to add additional trace, and you can use add traced. As you know, so this one is based on open tracing standard, and currently open tracing and open sensors merged into open telemetry. So at the moment, MicroProfile is adopting open telemetry. So this one will be stabilized and then replaced by MicroProfile telemetry, hopefully in the next release. So it's next thing is kind of get started. So how can you create a micro profile application? You can go to start.microprofile.io, or you can use a VS Code. If you anybody use a VS Code IDE, oh cool, that's good. I'm going to do a demo here. And then IntelliJ, anybody? Okay, it's so interesting to know is. VS Code is the majority of you. so it's also we have IntelliJ plugin as well. And if you use Open Liberty, we also have an Open Liberty starter. You can directly create a micro profile application running on Liberty. So let me start the demo now. So it's, I will directly go to the VS Code. So it's, so I have a VS Code MicroProfile extension pack installed. So I will to maybe I will cloud native for Java, and I will use Vision 4.1. I running on Open Liberty, use Java 11, create a Maven. Yeah, we will get all of them. And then. Okay, so I can put in this folder. So with that, we'll give you like two services, service A and service B. So basically, service A will directly call into service B. So and it's directly running on Open Liberty. So let me directly start the like this service A first, and at same time, I go to service B. I will start that. So where is it running? So basically, it's like in service A. So it's if you it's the source code here. So it's like this is. Application, so it's all the JAX-RS application, and this is the hello controller. So it's in service, so this is the service A, and service B, so it's, it has two endpoints. One is the client, so basically this one is kind of, it has operation do something, and also the other one is kind of secured. So basically, this endpoint is secured is only allow like a protected available to be accessed, and for the service A, it can directly call into service B. So it's again, I use the MicroProfile REST client, so directly do like create an interface or service B, do something. As you can see, it's directly being configured. This is the service B's endpoint. And in service, in other JAX-RS, other classes, I just directly inject a REST client, and then I can directly call it. So service A, both service A and service B started. So it's the service A is on the 9080. So if I go to the, so it's the service A. So this is the kind of the REST client, so that's directly call into the REST client. So here is the response. So if I go back to here, so if I change the service, change here, like this is service B. If I say service B, service B. I save this one. So this is kind of, now I go back here. So you can see it pick up straight away. So this is the Open Liberty dev mode. So it's the next thing I want to show you is kind of the, in service A. In service A, I want do something else. I want to say hello. Maybe I will say hello, maybe a conference. So it's for this conference, I don't want to hard code here. I want to inject. I want to use a MicroProfile config to directly inject it. So I will say, okay, the property is called conference, and it is a string, so conf. If I save that, so it's a, then, as you can see, so the conference is not directly, so it's kind of the specified. So I need to specify somewhere. So in MicroProfile, so there's the offer place is MicroProfile config or properties. So I can say conference is automatically picked up. Maybe OSS summit. So client, so it's directly calling here. Let's go back here. So you can say automatically say hello OSS summit. So this is the next thing is I want to demonstrate. For example, if a service B is not behaving. So sometimes it's slow, and sometimes it's not working. So let me directly copy a snippet here, so it's in service B. Let me put a bug in service B. So it's. V there. So let me throw exception. If I go back here, as you can see, and now it's really slow, right? And then later on it's not responding. So in these circumstances, for example, you are the owner of the service A. How can you fix your service A without fixing service B? And you may think, oh, why don't you fix service B? Sometimes you don't have authority to fix service B. So all you can do is you can use the MicroProfile fault tolerance. You can retry it. And also, because it's a timeout, it's very slow, and then you can say, okay, I don't have time to wait for it, and I only wait for 200 milliseconds, if not, and we'll time out. When you use a timeout, always the best practice to make it synchronized operation. So you will use the Java 8 completion stage, return that. And import that, and then you can do the completable future completed stage. Let me save that. So if I save this one, now go back to here. So you can, you don't see any slowness, any, because once it's slow, it's automatically kind of the, did a retry. Like you can see 17 directly jumped to 18 because I retried. And then the next one is succeeded. So it's, this is a kind of, you create like a resilient microservice. The other best practice is that you can use a fallback. So when you use a fallback, so you can say fallback method, and here a, maybe it's the same, my fallback, and in the cloud, and sometimes the backend is not responding, and you can also go to alternative like operation. So in here, maybe it's in here, directly delete that. And here we see this is my fallback. Save that. So this is like how to use create a resilient microservices. So it's so the next thing is like the document your cloud native applications. Actually, it's right now, if you go back to the application here, like without you doing anything, it's also automatically been like documented. And also the Open Liberty has the open API / UI. So it's like give you directly display all these kind of the endpoint. So we are dealing with this. And as you can see, the 200 is automatically documented. And then you can add additional documentation by using like a MicroProfile Open API. So here, if I say like what's the response 404 means, what's the response 200 means, and you can add that. Let me also copy the import here. Go back here. Let me save that. So it's in here, if you can see, it's automatically been documented. You can even try it out. Try it out if I say OSS, submit, and execute. And you can see the response like this. It's a kind of, also you can see 200 means and 404 means. So that's a kind of documentation. The other one is kind of the, the metrics. So there's the endpoint / metrics. You can see the retry, the fault tolerance automatically give you retry. Metrics, and also the like the JAX-RS or the invocation give you metrics, and also the class loading give you the metrics. So you automatically got all the metrics. If you want, and also you can use MicroProfile metrics, like annotation, you can add more metrics. For example, here you can say add simply timed. And then you can say name equals more metrics, for example. And you will get more metrics. So the other thing is kind of, I talk about MicroProfile health. So here is the kind of liveness. You can specify what means is live. Maybe it's it still have RAM. And the readiness is maybe it's when it's ready. Maybe when it's be able to connect to the database is ready. And then startup is when it's up. So you can specify, you implement this health check method. And in MicroProfile health, it's automatically give you the all the endpoint, like / live and / ready, and et cetera. So the next thing is, I want to say is kind of the tracing availability. So it's so in here, as you can see, we create a CN4G. So I didn't do anything else, and all the trees and etc. automatically trace span automatically correlated to see where is the time is spent and etc. So the next thing is we'll talk about security. So it's in here, like I mentioned, this is the only role protected is able to do the invocation. So in the service A, do the secure, and when they're trying to invoke the secured backend, it can use like a web target, this is the Jakarta REST, is directly Jakarta REST client. So call the backend, and when the call backend, also the push the header, like authorization this header with the JSON payload. This is when the create a JSON payload, you can see here UPN, and also the group is set protected. At the moment, if I directly call the the secured backend, so it's, this is you got a response back. However, if I change that, if I change the service B, I say okay, no longer protected. I want only super able to access me. And now, if I call it, I got forbidden. So it's let me change it back. So change it back. Actually, you can also inject a JSON web token. So you can peek into what's the token like. So it's, you can inject that. You will see token, and then you can see token. You can the token get a raw token. Let me save that. Let's have a quick look at what a token is like. So you can see, this token. This is because this is all the 64 encoded. So if you go to the JWT.io, you can decode that. So you can decode that sounds like a gibberish string. If you put it in here, you can see here is the user unprotected. So this is kind of the quick bird's eye view of the kind of the MicroProfile application. How can you create it? It's very straightforward. So let me go back to the slide. Talk about a little bit about the cloud. So it's when you kind of into the cloud, actually you need to first build your application, and then containerize the application, and then interact with Kubernetes. So it's in MicroProfile, MicroProfile config can directly in the Kubernetes, you can create a config map and then specify the properties, and then you can map to environment variables, and then MicroProfile can directly inject that into your application. And the next thing is I mentioned about the endpoint / health / ready, and then this directly mirror into the Kubernetes readiness probe and liveness probe and etc. I will show you in a minute in my demo. So it's and again, if you use Istio saying, okay, if you want to use Istio and trace your application, this is headers must be propagated. And then the open tracing automatically propagates all of them for you. So it's a really, really nice integration ecosystem. So in summary, you use a MicroProfile as a programming model, and you can still assure it works really well with Kubernetes. So this is a useful link for the if you want to find more about MicroProfile, go in here. And if you want to learn about MicroProfile, and go to openliberty.io/guides and learn about Kubernetes. And also I wrote a couple blogs about compare Spring and MicroProfile, because this kind of this direct is very comparable to technologies. And also I wrote a blog about how to use MicroProfile in the service mesh architecture. And this is a link for the Amazon like a book if you want to buy it from Amazon. So with that, let me go back to the kind of the coding again. So next thing is I want to show you here, already created this one. So it's in order save time. So the next thing you do, you just Maven verify to package your application, and then you create a Docker file. So I can see this Docker file. You do a Open Liberty and Java 11 Open G9. And then you copy the config and copy the wall and run the config.sh to create the Docker image. And then you do a Docker build and directly build it. So this is the next thing is kind of the deployment. So basically is when you want to deploy to Kubernetes and you create a deployment, you create a services. So I have two microservices, two cloud native applications. It's Apple A and also Apple B. So Apple A, the first thing is I want to find out the Apple B's endpoint. Once you deploy to Kubernetes, no longer localhost 9080. So that will be a service name and then the like a port and then this URL. So you can configure it. You can see it's the kind of you can configure that very easily as an environment variable. The other thing is the conference. Is we hardcode conference, the OSS Summit. And in here, you can overwrite it. You can say Open Source Summit 2020. Again, you can connect with Kubernetes liveness probe and also the readiness probe. So you can use a MicroProfile like the /health/live/health/ready and directly communicate to it. So it's and then is this app based deployment is kind of it listen to 9080, and then this is service. So I deployed this service like A is a node port. So basically you can access it via the port 380 and map to the internal core port is 9080. And this one is the service based cluster IP. So it's let me directly go in here. So if I do a kube control get services, so you can see it's kind of I have two services up running. It's a 9080 map to 380. Let me go to the here. Let me go to the localhost 380. So it's running in Docker desktop. So here, now you can click on that. You can see it's directly calling to the service B because the conference I changed to be OSS Summit 2022. So you can display this straight away. So this is a kind of quick bird's eye view into the kind of the create your cloud native application and deploy to Kubernetes. You can see it's within these 20 minutes you are up running. So and then is in my Kubernetes actually is also I specify actually give me replicas too. So if I go back here. Make it bigger. If I do kube control, get ports. So you can see two is service A and two is service B. So it's one final thing to just talk about. So it's again I said in the IBM booth we have I have a book signing book signing, and then is kind of the tomorrow is 5:30 to 6:30 please turn up and grab a copy. And then there's a challenge, also the machine learning, and also play a game, Space Rover challenge. It's really fun, so over there. And then you can get a lot of swag. We have water bottle, hats, and et cetera. And this is a book, and then it's, this is from Keynote. It's, we're very devoted to open source SSF. So please also get involved. So that's the end of this talk. I don't know whether I have any, probably I don't have any time for questions. Maybe, yeah, if you have questions, find me at IBM booth or find me here so that next speaker can set up their presentation. Thank you so much for coming, and yeah.